Good afternoon and very welcome to this ERCnet webinar. My name is Francesco Emma and I'm speaking from my office in Rome. So before starting, as usual, let me remind you that your microphones are turned off, but during and after the webinar, you can send in your question through the application that is present on your screen, and I will ask your question at the end of the presentation. The webinar will last approximately 30 minutes, and we will then have approximately 15 minutes available for questions. Our speaker today is Marina Noris from Bergamo. Marina is the head of the Laboratory of Immunology and Genetic and Renal Diseases at the Mario Negri Institute in Bergamo. She is a distinguished member of the European Complement Network Board. She's an associate editor of the Journal of Immunology, and she's also a member of the Research Club of Top Italian Women Scientists. Marina's work is known to most of you. She has published in top-ranking journals on several fields of nephrology, spanning from genetic diseases to renal transplantation. One of her main fields of interest, however, has always been complement-associated diseases, to which she has contributed with seminal work that most of you already know. Her laboratory is a reference center for biochemical and genetic diagnosis of patients with hemolytic uremic syndrome, TTP, C3 glomerulopathies, steroid-resistant nephrotic syndromes, and polycystic kidney disease. The title of her talk today is Unrevealing the Pathophysiology of HOS in Light of Recent Discoveries of Complement Activation. Marina?
Okay.
No, you're on, Marina. You can start talking.
Can I start? Because do I have to start?
No, you're fine. Just go ahead and you start your work.
Okay.
Everybody can listen to you.
Okay. So hello to everybody. Thank you, Francesco, for your nice presentation. I'm talking today about a 20 year of work on atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome. This disease belongs to the group of diseases that share a common histology characteristic that is swelling and detachment of endothelial cells with formation of thrombi and obstruction of the vessel lumina of the microcirculation of several organs. As a consequence of this endothelial lesion, there is a severe tissue ischemia causing multi-organ dysfunction. But the stenosis also causes an increase in shear stress that results in red blood cell fragmentation and anemia. In addition, the formation of microthrombi on the surface of endothelial cells cause thrombosis and thrombocytopenia due to platelet consumption. Depending on the what is now known about the underlying specific pathogenetic mechanism, there are different subgroup of thrombotic microangiopathies. There is the typical hemolytic uremic syndrome diarrhea associated in children that is caused by certain bacteria that produce Shiga like toxin that damage the endothelial cells. Then there is the atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome that is associated with defective complement regulation due to gene mutation or autoantibodies. The thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura is instead caused by a severe deficiency in the plasma metalloprotease Ediams-13 that cleaves BWF maltimers. And finally, there is a broad gray area of diseases that are called secondary thrombotic microangiopathies that are associated with a number of conditions like autoimmune systemic diseases, other glomerulopathies, transplantation infections, or conditions that activate the endothelium and the complement. And the evidence is emerging that at least in a subgroup of this patient, there is a genetic predisposition to defective complement regulation. I will focus my talk today on atypical HOS. Atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome is a very rare condition that has an overall incidence of about 0.5 to 2 cases for 1 million people per year. There is no sex difference, and the disease manifests with the typical triad of thrombocytopenia, anemia, and renal acute renal failure. Until a few years ago, the disease was very, very severe and was characterized by a poor outcome, particularly in patients with certain genetic abnormalities. And indeed, the survival curve that I'm showing here was very dramatic, with almost 80% of patients developing end-stage renal disease or dying in a few years. However, the knowledge that has been acquired in the last 20 years has led to the comprehension of the causes of this disease and finally the fortunate case of the discovery of a cure. So let me try to summarize you what we and other groups, mainly in Europe, have done in these years. This is the first step that I believe was the most important to unravel the pathophysiology and the role of complement in this disease. Based on isolated case reports in literature showing evidence of intravascular complement activation, we first looked at levels of complement parameters, C3 and C4, in a few patients with very severe diseases from our registry. And what we found, we observed, was that about 60% of patients had lower than normal serum C3 levels in their circulation. They were essentially mildly reduced levels, but however, they were constantly consistently found in cases versus controls. At variance, the levels of C4 were roughly normal in patients with atypical HOS. To understand the meaning of these findings, for those people that are not familiar with this matter, I'm here showing the complement activation cascades. The complement system is very important for the defense against bacterial infections and clearance of immunocomplexes. And the cascade is organized in three activation pathways: the classical pathway, the lectin pathway, and the alternative pathway. All these three cascades are activated by bacterial products or by immunocomplexes and led to the formation of enzyme complexes that are called the C3 convertases. These enzymes cleave C3, the third fraction of complement C3, into C3B that deposits on the target cells. C3B also enters into the composition of other complexes that are called the C5 convertases that cleave C5, activating the terminal complement pathway and leading to the formation of the C5B29 membrane attack complex that causes cell lysis. I wish to underline two important points. First, in the classical and lectin pathway cascades, you can appreciate the involvement of both C4 and C3, causing both C4 and C3 consumption, while only C3 is involved in the alternative pathway. Thus, the finding in patients with atypical HOS of low C3 levels but normal C4 pointed the attention on the alternative pathway. Another important point is that the alternative pathway is always activated at a low degree by a sort of spontaneous hydrolysis of C3 that is called takeover. It's like of a ready-to-go alarm of our immune system that must be very closely controlled by a number of complement regulators that are shown here in the screen, that dissect among the pathogens that should be attacked by complement and our cells that should be protected. And the most important of these compounds is complement factor H. Complement factor H is... there is something not working because the screen... Okay, sorry. Complement factor age is a protein produced by the liver and is circulating in plasma, and is made by 20 short consensus repeats. This short consensus repeat has a number of functions. In particular, the first four N-terminus repeats are important for the binding to C3b and for the regulatory function, while the two C-terminus repeats are important to recognize the surface proteoglycans in our cells, particularly in endothelial cells, and allow factor age to protect our cells from complement attack. This gene was the first that was investigated in patients with atypical AGOS, and a number of groups have studied the genetics of this particular target during the last years, discovering more than 100 different genetic abnormalities that account for about 30% of patients with atypical AGOS. Notably, most of them are heterozygous, and as you can see here in this slide, most of them cluster in the surface recognition domain. To understand the meaning of this finding, I have this cartoon that shows the function of factor age in regulating complement. Factor age can regulate complement in fluid phase, since by the regulatory domain, recognize C3b and induce the dissociation of the C3 convertase, and also favor by cofactor activity the degradation of C3b to inactive C3b by factor I. But thanks to the red surface recognition domain, factor age can bind to our cells and exert complement regulatory activity on endothelial cells and other cells of our body. And this is very important to understand the pathophysiology of AGOS, since functional studies that we have done on mutant proteins found in patients with atypical AGOS document that even a single change, amino acidic change, in the last SCR of factor age is enough to reduce impressively the capability of the protein to bind to endothelial cells. You can appreciate here the difference between wild-type factor age and mutant factor age on confocal microscopy image of endothelial cells, and also by FACS analysis. So the consequences of these mutations are summarized in this cartoon. What happens? In patients with factor age mutation, the protein can normally regulate complement in a fluid phase, but cannot recognize the cell surface, and as a consequence, there is no C3 degradation, no C3 convertase dissociation, and finally, there is the activation of the terminal complement cascade with the formation of C5b29. But the things in AGOS are very complex, and it's not so easy to understand all the genetic abnormalities because, in addition to single point mutation, there are also complex genomic abnormalities affecting factor age. And these genomic abnormalities are due to the fact that in the chromosomal area where factor age is mapped, there are five factor age-related genes in tandem that are very homologous to factor age genes. And these five genes produce proteins that do not have complement regulatory activity. The consequence of these high homologies is the possibility that a non-allelic homologous recombination may occur during meiosis, giving rise to hybrid genes. Here, to exemplify the situation, I'm showing you the first hybrid gene that was reported by the group of Tim Goodship in patients with atypical AGOS and derives from the fusion of factor age with the last terminus part of CFAGR1, and this is the new gene. What is important to underline is that these abnormalities cannot be detected by Sanger or next generation sequences, but require particular assays that detect copy number variations. In addition to this particular gene, there are a number of other fusion genes that have been reported by us and other groups in association with patients with atypical HOS that account for about 5 to 8% of patients. All share the fact that in these hybrid genes and the corresponding hybrid proteins, the C-terminus part, the recognition domain of factor H, is substituted by CFHR1 or by CFHR3. The result is a protein that can regulate complement in fluid phase, but cannot bind to endothelial cell surface and cannot regulate complement on solid phase level. In addition to genetic abnormalities, there are also factor H antibodies that have been found in patients with atypical HOS. And these mainly cluster in children and account for about 8% of patients. I wish to underline that most antibodies recognize the C-terminus part of factor H, but also recognize CFHR1, the complement factor H receptor 1. And to understand the pathophysiology of these antibodies, another important observation to know is that in more than 90% of patients carrying these autoantibodies, there is the homozygous deletion of the gene encoding CFHR1. So this patient has a complete deficiency of CFHR1. And this finding raised the hypothesis that the origin of these autoantibodies derived from a failure for central or peripheral tolerance to CFHR1 in this subject that completely lack the protein. Of course, this hypothesis needs further studies, but evidence are emerging that indeed this may be the case. There are, in addition to factor H, a number of abnormalities in other complement regulatory genes that have been reported in atypical HOS. I'm just giving you the example of another complement regulator that is membrane cofactor protein that at variance with factor H is a transmembrane protein that is highly expressed in the kidney and in particular in endothelial cells. Like factor H, this protein acts as a cofactor and favors C3b degradation. Loss of function heterozygous variants have been found in about 10% of patients with atypical HOS, and functional studies done by us and other groups have documented that this mutation results in either a protein that cannot bind to C3b or in a protein that is not expressed on endothelial cells. The result is an unpaired degradation of C3b and finally the formation of the C5b29 on cell surfaces. In addition to loss of function mutation in a complement regulator, there are also gain of function mutation that affect the two components of the C3 convertase that are C3 and factor B. Here I'm giving you the example of C3 mutation that are present in about 7 to 10% of patients. What happens to patients with this type of abnormalities? There is a mutant C3b that does not recognize the complement regulator, so is not inactivated. But in some patients also this mutant protein is very active in form a C3 convertase with a high affinity to factor B, so that there is no degradation of the protein, but also no dissociation of the C3 convertase complex. As a consequence, again, we have an hyperactivation of complement on cell surface and the formation of the membrane attack complex. So I have no time to show you all the work that has been done also with the other genes, but here I'm summarizing you all the discovery that have been done in patients with atypical HOS. And as you can realize, and I'm happy to tell, that the genetics of HOS is a full European discovery. So all genes were and abnormalities were reported for the first time in Italy and France, Spain, Germany, and England, and include also mutation in factor I, mutation in factor B, and thrombomodulin. And overall, these abnormalities account for about 60% of cases. So we have still a lot of work to be done to fully disclose the genetics underlying this disease. But the things are even more complex. And this is due to a number of findings that have been accumulating the last years. Particular one of the issue is the incomplete penetrance of the disease in carriers of complement genetic abnormalities. Here I show you an example from our registry that is very clear. You can appreciate here with an asterisk a number of individuals that carry a pathogenetic variant in factor H. However, only children in the third generation develop the disease, while the father is fully unaffected and the grandfather developed the disease only very late in life, at 82 years of age. So this slide tells us two things. First, that there should be other genetic components that may predispose to have a more severe disease, for instance, in subject of the third generation. And second, that a healthy carrier should be not considered healthy, but should be considered at risk because the disease may occur at any age during life. And the oligogenic nature of this disease is fully supported by this study that was done thanks to the collaboration of four independent European cohorts and coordinated by our center in overall almost 800 patients from all over Europe. And you can realize that by the complete genetic screening, we found that about 10% of patients overall carried mutation, more than one mutation in two or even three genes of the complement system. In particular, this applied to patients with MCP or factor I variants that in about one quarter of cases carry another mutation in another complement gene. In addition to rare pathogenetic variants, evidence is also accumulating that common polymorphisms, particularly in factor age, may contribute to predispose to the disease, particularly in patients that also carry a complement gene mutation. So in 2003, by analyzing our cohort of patients, we found that three variants, common variants in the factor age gene, one in the promoter, one in SCR11 and one in SCR16, were associated with a significantly higher odd ratio to AGOS as compared to a control population. And the combination of the three variants were associated with an even higher risk for the disease. Later on, it was discovered that these three variants, the T variant in the promoter, the G variant in SCR11, and the T variant in SCR16, all belong to a particular haplotype that is called H3, that was confirmed to be associated with risk of atypical AGOS. And as I told you before, the risk is particularly evident when we consider families in which there are carriers of pathogenetic variants in factor age. Here is an example from our registry. There is a proband who developed a very severe disease early in life, who inherited this nonsense, very severe pathogenetic mutation in factor age from the father, who however is healthy. And there are also a number of other healthy carriers in the family that never developed the disease. However, looking at common polymorphism and the factor age haplotype for this polymorphism, we found that the proband inherited the risk haplotype H3 from the mother, while the other subjects that are carrier of the mutation inherited a protective haplotype, the H4. This is a single family, but we recently confirmed in unpublished data from our registry by looking at 21 families with factor age mutations, including 26 patients with the disease and 47 unaffected carrier relatives of the same mutation. And we found that the H3 haplotype on the other allele, the wild type allele inherited from the other parent, was largely more frequent in affected subjects than in healthy relatives that carry the same pathogenetic variants, indicating that this H3 haplotype is a determinant of the penetrance of the disease in subjects that carry also factor age mutations. Even in a subject with multiple genetic risk factors, however, the disease may occur in adulthood or in late childhood. And this often occurs in concomitance with a triggering event that may be an upper respiratory tract infection or gastrointestinal infection, pregnancy, or other condition that may trigger complement and induce the disease in a subject that carry a genetic predisposing factor. And that indeed the triggering event may be important in a context of a genetic predisposing individual is also confirmed by this unpublished data from our registry in patients with secondary forms of HOS, either pregnancies associated with malignant hypertension, systemic diseases of de novo post-transplant TMA, or other nephropathies, and showing that 20 to 40% of these patients also carry mutation in complement gene, indicating the importance of the concomitance between genetic predisposition and triggering events. Altogether, this complex combination of environmental and genetic predisposing factor share in common two facts. First, a target organ that is the kidney, and second, a target cell that is the endothelial cell. And this is documented by the deposits that can be found at the level of C3 and C5b29 on endothelial cell of the glomeruli of patients with this is the case of a patient with atypical HOS and the factor age mutation. But which are the consequences of this type of complement dysregulation? The consequences are very profound, and I have no time to show you all the work that is being done by our group, but also by many other groups, mainly in Europe, showing that the activation of the terminal complement pathway as a consequence of all these abnormalities on endothelial cells shift the endothelial cell phenotype from an antithrombotic to a prothrombogenic phenotype with shedding of thrombomodulin, the exocytosis of P-selectin and the binding of VWF, that finally result in a platelet aggregation and in the activation of the coagulation system. But the final proof that indeed this system is linked to the disease derived from clinical trials and from the clinical practice showing that the eculizumab, that is an anti-C5 monoclonal antibody that block the terminal pathway of complement activation, was indeed effective in also inducing disease remission and preventing disease reactivation in patients with atypical HOS. And just to give you an idea, these were the published survival course that appeared in our paper in 2010 in the pre-eculizumab area, showing, as you can appreciate, that most patients develop end-stage renal disease or died during the follow-up. And these are the data that derived from the clinical trials of eculizumab, showing instead the reverse, so the recovery of a platelet count that is sustained over time, and also the sustained recovery of the GFR in patients treated with eculizumab. But now we have a pathophysiology, we have a cure. The problem is how a clinician can rapidly diagnose a complement-mediated atypic RGOS in a patient that present in the clinical nel the clinical practice. I'm giving you an example. First of all, I must tell you that the genetic studies are important, but they take time. They are very complex. And this time is not fitting with the clinical need because all people that work with this disease know very, very well that the treatment should be started as soon as possible without waiting for all the results of genetic analysis. So what can we do and what the lab can help the clinician to make a diagnosis of complement mediated disease. Here is an example that may be common in a clinical ground. Is an adult with suspicion of TMA with all the symptoms of thrombocytopenia, hemolytic anemia, renal impairment. TTP is excluded because Evian-13 is normal, and also diarrhea, shigatoxin-associated AGOS is excluded. However, there are no evidence in the circulation of complement activation because C3 and C4 are normal, and also plasma C5b29 levels are normal. The question now is, can this be an atypical AGOS? No, because circulating complement parameters are normal, or yes, could be, but further tests are needed. And the correct answer is not for you, but it's just to present the case. I'm giving you the answer is yes, it could be, but we need further tested. And indeed, we performed a number of studies to search for these tests. First of all, we looked overall to the levels of C3 and plasma C5b29 in our patients, and indeed we confirmed that even during the acute phase of the disease, about 50% of patients with a genetic diagnosis of atypical AGOS do not have abnormal a complement profile in the circulation. So a normal complement profile does not exclude atypical AGOS. And this is can be understood if we remember my previous slide showing that mutation and genetic abnormalities associated with atypical AGOS are associated with normal fluid phase complement regulation, but abnormal solid phase complement regulation. So we have to look at this level. And with this idea in mind, we set up a test, an ex vivo test, that was based on the use of a human microvascular endothelial cell line that were either tested in a resting condition or after activation with ADP. These cells were then exposed to serum from healthy controls or from patients with atypical AGOS. And thereafter, the deposition of the C5b29 complex was analyzed by confocal microscopy. What we observed in a huge number of patients was that on a resting endothelium, only serum taken during the acute phase of the disease induced higher than normal C5b29 formation as compared to the normal range, while in remission the deposits were in the normal limit, indicating that this test on resting endothelium is very sensitive to detect disease activity. What happens on an endothelium that is preactivated with ADP to mimic a triggering event that may occur in vivo? What happens is that patients with atypical AGOS, both during the acute phase but also studying in remission out of any treatment, induce higher than normal C5b29 deposition on endothelium, showing 100% sensitivity to detect complement dysregulation. And this indicated that patients with a complement dysregulation due to genetic defects or autoantibodies are at risk of relapses upon a triggering event may perturb the complement system or the endothelium endothelium and induce a C5B2 information on their vasculature. Another important observation that we did is that this abnormality could be detected independently from the underlying abnormality and also in patients without identified genetic abnormalities, indicating that we are still to discover additional predisposing factors that may induce complement dysregulation and predispose to atypical AGOS. Another important observation is shown in this slide, in that and we obtained this observation in patients studied before and after eculizumab treatment. And as you can appreciate, while before eculizumab treatment, there was a higher than normal C5B29 deposition on ADP-activated endothelial cells, all patients showed a full normalization of their deposits after eculizumab treatment. And this was completely different from the finding with plasma C5B29 levels that, as you can appreciate, were very variable and did not appreciably change after eculizumab. So, the solid phase versus the fluid phase complement activation gave different information, with the solid phase being the most informative one. So let's return to our case. The case that I showed you a few slides ago that showed the normal complement profile in the circulation when was analyzed with the test on resting and non-activated endothelial cells showed abnormal complement deposits indicating an acute disease that was complement mediated. The patient was treated with eculizumab, which resulted in a full normalization of renal parameters and also in a normalization of C5B29 deposits. So the test is useful to diagnose atypical AGOS associated with complement dysregulation. But now there is another problem because patients, we know that patients respond to eculizumab, but we also know that the treatment is very expensive and also is associated with a relevant risk of infection. So the question that many clinicians and also many patients put is whether or not they should give the drug every 2 weeks forever to their patients. And indeed, there are published uncontrolled studies in literature describing a number of patients that underwent eculizumab tapering and even discontinuation. For instance, this is a report from the French group. Is a retrospective study that collected data from 38 patients who underwent eculizumab discontinuation and at least a 2 year follow-up. And the author found that the presence of the mutation in factor H or MCP was associated with high risk of relapses. Indeed, you can see that about 70% of patients with factor H mutations experienced a disease relapse during the follow-up, while patients without a mutation had a very nice follow-up without relapse. However, these data were not confirmed by other studies, and this is another survey that collected about 52 case reports who discontinued eculizumab, and among them 31%, 16 patients, had a subsequent TMA. In addition, among data from clinical trials, 12 patients among the 61 who discontinued eculizumab experienced 15 TMA complications. Notably, most of these cases recovered renal function and hematological normalization upon restart of eculizumab. However, the finding of this second paper is that TMA relapse was independent from the identified genetic mutation. Even in the presence of this without genetic mutation or high-risk polymorphism or autoantibodies, some patients experience a disease relapse. So we need a biomarker that could help the clinician to follow the patients and to identify patients that are at risk of relapses. With this problem in mind, we ask whether it is possible to apply the ex vivo test of C5B29 deposition to monitor tapering and the discontinuation of eculizumab in patients with atypical RGOS. Here I'm showing you the results of a paper that is now under revision and summarizing the data from 22 patients that underwent eculizumab tapering and discontinuation from our registry. You can appreciate these are the data on resting endothelial cells. And you can appreciate that most patients maintained the C5B29 deposition on resting endothelial cells in the normal range during the tapering and even during the discontinuation. Only a subgroup of these patients experienced an elevation over normal range of these deposits, and notably, five of them, the arrows, had a disease relapse in concomitance or even before worsening of clinical parameters. So the they had a elevation of C5B29 deposits on resting endothelial cells in concomitance with or even before the worsening of clinical parameters, indicating that the test could be sensitive to detect disease relapses and or even may detect the relapses in advance to clinical parameters. I show you an example of these cases that is regard a 24-year-old woman who had a recurrent plasma-dependent RGOS associated with heterozygous factor A mutation. During a recurrence of the disease, the patient was treated with eculizumab, resulting in a disease full disease remission. After 7 months of treatment, every 2 weeks, the eculizumab was the interval between doses was increased, and the eculizumab was stopped. However, at 6 months after cessation, you may appreciate the increase of C5B29 deposits that preceded by 1 month the clinical signs of disease reactivation. Here I'm giving another example of a patient who instead had a normal follow-up during eculizumab tapering and also normal levels of C5B29 deposits. I'm out of time.
Nearly. I think you need to wrap up.
Okay, so I'm just showing you the last two slides where I'm comparing the parameters, a number of parameters that we have tested in different conditions, plasma C5B29 levels, the CH50, that is to say the complement residual activity, and to the C5 deposition test. And you can see that the plasma C5B29 does not change during acute phase and the remission with or without eculizumab and during tapering. CH50 is normal during acute phase of RGOS and also in remission and only decrease during eculizumab therapy, but normalize during eculizumab tapering discontinuation without this setting between no relapse and relapses. While you can appreciate that the test on C5B29 deposition on resting endothelial cells that is specifically abnormal during the acute phase of the disease and also during relapses after eculizumab discontinuation. This is a protocol that we have designed for progressive tapering of patients after eculizumab administration for more than 1 year. linear. And you may appreciate that there is a progressive tapering of eculizumab, and at each time point there is the assay of course clinical parameters, but also the assay of complement C5B29 deposition on endothelial cells. So to conclude, all the work that has been done during these years has led to the discovery of a therapy for AGOS, but also has burst the interest of industry for a number of complement regulators. I'm showing you the C5, the complement regulators on clinical development that target the terminal complement pathway, so that there are a number of drugs that are under clinical development. And in the next future, I hope that we will have the tools to choose the suitable complement regulator and the suitable posiology for each patient toward a personalized therapy. I wish to thank you for the attention and to thank all people in the lab for their invaluable work, and Giuseppe Remuzzi and Ariela Benigni for their supervision. And thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
I'm now moving to multiple choice questions. Is it correct, Francesco?
Let's try quickly to the questions so that we can take a few questions. So to the audience, please send in your questions so that after the multiple choice question, I can convey your questions.
Okay. Okay, so this is the first multiple choice questions. I'm waiting 30 seconds for the answer. Okay, there is overall answer. No, let me wait. Okay, I wait 30 minutes, 30 seconds. Okay, I think that I can close.
Yeah.
Okay, so 81% answer this one, activation. Okay, okay, so let me, okay, and 81% was right. Let's move to the second one. Okay, what I can have to do? Okay, second one, start. Okay, 30 seconds. Okay, I close. Okay, and 90% was right. Okay, third one. Dov'è? Okay, third one. Okay, start. Okay. Okay, I'm closing. 88% was right, and so I'm happy that I was enough clear. I hope so. Okay, so I finished my multiple choice question.
Okay, so right now I still don't have any questions, so those of you who have questions, please send them in. Marina, this was very enlightening. I will just ask you a few questions. Now, one thing that we've always been wondering is how long does the effect of eculizumab last in a patient with HOS? Now, with your test, you're in a unique position to be able to answer the question. So when you give a dose of eculizumab, for how long do patients are protected, and do you see that there are there is variability between different patients?
Yeah, thank you. You put a very important question because indeed there is a high variability from patient to patient. What we have seen by measuring both the level of eculizumab, but also CH50, but in particular the deposition of C5b-29 on activated endothelial cells is that most patients that are on chronic eculizumab treatment, that means at least for 6 months, may tolerate an interval between doses until 3 to even 4 weeks. But it depends from the specific underlying defect, because there are patients that may need more frequent eculizumab administration, even more frequent than the 2 weeks that are recommended by the company. So we had, for instance, a patient from Turin that need eculizumab every 1 week. While most patients may tolerate, after reaching a steady state level, intervals of 3 and even 2 to 4 weeks. But this must be monitored very carefully.
Okay, so I have two more questions, and again for the attendees, I don't see your question coming, so please I will ask these two questions to Marina, and then I will close the webinar unless you have questions. So these are the two questions I have for you. You mentioned that the current genetic testing can detect about 60%. Mutations in about 60% of patients. So what about the remaining 40%? Do you really think that there are more genes to be discovered, or could these just be explained by haplotypes that are now favorable?
Yeah, this is, again, you are putting very important question, Francesco, thank you. Among the 40% of patients that do not have known complement genetic abnormalities, it is, first we have to consider the patients with DGKA mutation that had no time to show today, that have been discovered in children very, very young infants, usually patients with an onset before 1 year of age. And this DGKA is the acylglycerol kinase epsilon that is a protein that is apparently related to complement. This is a particular form of the disease. This account for very, very early infant onset. As for the other patients, the answer is a mixed. I believe that there should be few particular cases that may have a particular mutation in particular genes, but I believe that most of the known cases are due to multiple complement abnormalities that may be haplotypes, common variants, and predisposing factors, HLA for antibodies, and many other conditions. So we are moving toward an oligogenic forms of the disease. It will be not so easy to discover than the previous 60%.
Okay, so I have one question, but maybe I will ask you the question and ask the Dr. Aucci, who sent in his question. He says, what is the rate of infection in your patients? Do you understand the question, or should we ask him to just send some
I'm trying to answer. If not, I'm ready to repeat. If the question is how common are infections as a trigger event of the disease, not excluding the Shiga toxin E. coli infection. So I'm talking about common infections like flu-like disease, pulmonitis, bronchitis, gastrointestinal infections. So in children are rather common. So in about 40 to 50% of children, often there is a prodromal infection that may be a common viral or bacterial infection. And this is logic if one think that in this patient there is a predisposition to complement dysregulation and clearly infection activate complement. But also in adults there may be a trigger infection that may cause the disease, particularly in patients with transplant because they are immunosuppressed and so they may are particularly prone to develop infection.
Okay,
I hope that this was the question.
No, actually, we receive a follow-up by Dr. Aucci, and actually his question is more how frequent infections are as a consequence of, I suspect, eculizumab treatment.
Sorry.
You know, but the question, this is why I wanted to ask some more specifics.
Okay.
So the question is how frequently do you see infections?
Severe infections, the most problem associated with eculizumab is a meningococcal infection, and provided that the patient undergo vaccination and antibiotic prophylaxis, the incidence of severe infection is rather rare, but is not zero. So there are cases reported in literature of cases of severe meningococcal infection, even in patients undergoing vaccination or antibiotic prophylaxis, because vaccination does not cover all the serotypes, and also antibiotic resistant strains may emerge. But likely are very rare cases, although we must consider this risk. Of course, other type of infections may occur not so severe, but anyway, or encapsulated bacteria that depend on terminal pathway for their clearance may be more frequent in patients with eculizumab treatment, even if they are not so severe like meningococcal infection.
Okay, now we'll close with the last question that I've always been wondering, Marina. Speaking about the risk of relapse, do you think that there is an age-related risk? By this I mean, do you think that with time, a patient that had a first episode, with time his risk of relapse decreases, so that the attitude may be different in a young child, in an adolescent, or in an adult with the same mutation?
It's a very delicate question. Usually, patients who develop the disease in childhood, by definition, have a more severe disease. So as early as is the onset, as more severe is the disease, and the risk of relapse may be higher. Because first of all of likely severe underlying defect, genetic defect, but also because of the exposure to infective episodes that are like linked to childhood and to scholarship. While in adults, a patient that has a disease in adult, in human always is mostly is in pregnancy, so we know which is the trigger event, but we suppose that the disease may be more prone to relapse. But it is, again, not an absolute fact, and we have to consider case by case. But I would be very cautious with a child, and more cautious than with an adult. I think that you, Francesco, may agree with me.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Marina. This was a wonderful webinar. Thank you everybody for attending the webinar. And as you can see on your screen, the next ERICnet webinar will be given by Jack Wetzel, who is an expert on membranous nephropathy and will be held on November 27. So we will all be waiting you in a couple of weeks' time. Thank you again, Marina, and goodbye to everybody.
Thank you, Francesco, and goodbye to, and thank you for attending.
Bye.
Bye.